All right, let's look at canned cycles. All right, so if certain operations, if you start thinking about them, become really obvious candidates for this thing called canned cycles. Let me just get that stuff out of the way there. Well, I should have animated something. That would have been nice. Well, let's see. Let me grab a canned cycle. I think I. All right, so here's a canned cycle on a lathe. This is a G71 cycle on this is Dwight's part of Dwight's senior project that he's been working on. So you can see this machine when you're turning on a lathe, you're making multiple passes to take a little bit off with each pass. So you're moving back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. But what you can do with a canned cycle is you can define sort of the profile of what you want the finished part to be. Let me just see if I can. So here's a look at it as it's getting closer and closer to the finished. This is just done with a few lines of code. All this back and forth, that's part of the canned cycle. So hopefully I'll get some images here that make a little bit more sense as we move along. All right, so in essence, what a canned cycle does is it allows you to pack a lot of information into a single line of code or into a few lines of code. So one example would be PEC drilling. All right, so as you're probably aware, when you're drilling deep holes, in general, you don't just go plowing through unless you've got some really nice through the spindle coolant and can flush those chips out. You go in, a few diameters of the tool for the first pass, and then you draw the cutter back out of the hole and pull the chips out. And then you go back down in a little bit deeper, and then you come back out and pull the chips out. And then you go in a little bit deeper, and then you pull the chips out. Well, if you had to program all of those Z moves individually, back and forth, in and out, just to drill a single hole, then it would take an awful lot of code or a lot of punch tape back in the day, or just a lot of code to manage all of those motions, when all you really are you can take all that motion and kind of codify it or encode it, is what I mean, where you can say, I want to go in and make pecs of, say, a quarter of an inch, and go in and out a quarter of an inch each time, and you can package all of that stuff into a single cycle. So here's an example of a PEC drilling cycle, and you can see here's the way the code would look down here: G83, Z negative 6.2, etc. And what you've done here is you've created one line of code that will actually have the cutter go in and out, in and out, in and out, with pecs that are 0.175 inches deep. So each subsequent time it goes in, it will drill to this level, then it will wrap it back out of the hole, and then drill back down over and over again until it's reached the bottom of the hole, which in this case is Z negative 0.62. Also, you can see we can package in here a feed rate just for the drilling operation. This R takes a little bit of explaining to do. Actually, I've got a link somewhere to Mark Terryberry's tip of the day, where he explains really nicely how this R works. And if you're in my class, we will have an assignment where you go in and basically use a spreadsheet to program some drilling cycles, and you will learn a little bit more about that retract plane, that R.1 in there. Let's see, what else did I leave out? The P is the pause at the bottom of the hole or a dwell. What that's good for, that's especially important in spot drilling, because with CNC, you can feed down and then retract immediately, and you can retract so fast that the drill bit has not had a chance to make a complete revolution, and so you can wind up with a hole that's not nice and conical at the end, but a hole that has sort of a sinusoidal surface on it as that cutting tool comes down, makes part of a revolution, and then comes back out before it's had a chance to go around at a complete time. So that's just a dwell at the bottom of the drill. Let's see, other things that you might expect. So up here, you see it has I, J, and K. This is a separate option to do the PEC drilling increment just ignore that for now. When we talk about doing the actual assignment, we'll unpack that then. We're not going to do it that way, so just ignore that for now. That will be just fine to ignore. But then you have X and Y. Those are obviously your hole locations. Now, something I should mention, once you've gotten into this G83 peck drilling cycle, if you give an X or Y location after that, any subsequent, if you just put like X3, you will get a hole there that will be drilled with these same parameters. So if you want to cancel a peck drilling cycle, you need to do a G80 and get out of it. And then you can worry about X and Y in your way around with G01s. Okay, you can also have canned cycles on a lathe. So this is an example of that. This is a G71. So this is the one that we saw earlier cutting out that punch, where we have a general shape that's defined, and we saw that it went back and forth and just cut away layer by layer to remove the material in a sequence of steps instead of just trying to come in here and just plow through and remove the material in one pass, which, as you know, that doesn't work. All right, so the G71 is that stock removal cycle, and you see that it takes some parameters. These are the parameters. Let's have a look at how those get used. So this is a real simple G71 program. You'll notice there's something new in here that we haven't seen. Well, we've seen it maybe the first week of class, and that is line numbers. So here you have line N1. Down here, another line number, N2. Notice that they don't have to be, this doesn't have to be N1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We only need line numbers where they are relevant. And what these line numbers are doing is they are drawing a picture, they're drawing the code of what the shape looks like of the finished part. Okay, so this is our profile. So what's happening between N1 and N2 is it's essentially drawing the profile of the finished part. And here before that, you see, here is our G71. Okay, so the G71 is our canned cycle that's going to go in and carve all of this out. So it obviously it needs to know the shape, and so that's what this P1 and Q2 are doing. Okay, so P1 says look at line number look for line number N1, and that's where it starts looking at the profile, and the profile goes through line number 2. So the ending block is designated with a Q, and it knows where to look because of the 2. So down here we have N2, that is line number 2. So it starts at P1, that means go look for N1, and then it ends at Q2, that means go look for N2. All right, and then D is the depth of cut for each pass. So that's how far in the tool is going to move to take the material off, just like it was in, you know, you did that in Tech 1711, you've done that in this, well, you did it in doing it in tool design before the COVID-19 end of the world happened. But anyway, then you have U and W. So these are finish allowances. Let me drop back up here. So U is the X finish allowance, that is the finish allowance on the diameter, okay, because on a lathe, the X diameter typically, X axis typically designates the diameter. So this leaves behind material in the diameter direction, and W leaves behind material along the axis of the part, along the Z axis. So in other words, if we have a positive value here for U and W, it's going to leave a little extra material on the outside of the part and on the faces of the part, on the ends of the part. So why would you want to do that? Well, this would be a roughing sequence. And so you'd come in here and you'd rough off this material. And then separately, if you were going to do a finishing sequence, like you see here, a finish pass, you would need some material left behind to actually remove. And so this is the material that you're leaving behind for that sequence. Now you can also see in here that we have our own feed rate packaged inside of this canned cycle. So what that means is when it comes down here to step through from N1 to N2, it's going to ignore this 6,000ths inch per revolution feed rate, and it's going to replace it with this more roughing feed rate, the 14 thousandths inches per revolution. All right, so hopefully that that makes a little bit of sense. So we step through this thing, we get to our G71, he looks ahead, finds out what this profile looks like, he breaks it down into 15 thousandths depths of cut, leaves behind some material, uses its own feed rate, comes through here, goes through, and then separately, when it comes out of here, now we have a finish pass, okay? So this is too is a canned cycle, and it's not going to leave behind any material, however. We could come in and use, we could apply a feed rate here, but we don't need to because you see when he starts and steps through, since there's not a feed rate applied here, he steps, comes in here, his first machining cut is this G01 move with a feed rate of 6 thou or the attached to it. Okay, so he's going to go at 6 thousandths inches per revolution through this sequence down here. So he goes through, and there's nothing left behind. So what that means is he's going to actually just go through the motions of the profile and cut it to size. Let's see, that's another example. Really, the only difference is the profile is a little bit longer there. And he does a tool change here for his finish pass and some things like that. So same sort of idea, but this should kind of start to make sense to you. Now you see you got G71. This is our canned cycle. Notice it starts at P1. That means look at line N1. I kind of repeating myself. Notice this one doesn't end at P2, though. It ends at line 11, indicated by the Q. So we come down here. All of this gets included until we get down here to line N11. So really no difference there. Just another look at a canned cycle. All right, so when you run your canned cycle, sometimes you'll get an error that's a little bit intriguing. You might see an error that says non-monotonic cycle. This I'll put a link out. Oh, there it is. Okay, so there is a link to Mark Terryberry's explanation of what's going on there. Probably much better than I could explain it. But essentially, a monotonic cycle, a type 1 cycle, is one where once you've come in to start cutting, you only increase the diameter, or the diameter increases. Let's just see if I can, let's try to illustrate that. Okay, so here's our part getting machined, and it's only getting larger as we machine. Okay, so that's a monotonic increase. It's only moving in one direction. It's only getting larger. A non-monotonic sequence might look something like this, where you go in and out. Of course, that'd be kind of difficult to machine, but you know, you could do it with certain tools. Okay, so this is a non-monotonic block where you're going in and out and in and out. All right, the way that if you don't explicitly put an X and a Z move in the first block of the canned cycle, then it will assume that you don't want to move in and out. And if you do move in and out, it's some kind of an error. And so you'll get this non-monotonic error, which if you're not acquainted with it, it's kind of like, what in the heck is that? But anyway, that's what it is. And I will I'll leave that to Mark Terryberry to explain to you. He does a really, really good job of that. They put a lot of effort into those videos. So they are, I mean, all of them are worth watching. That one is the one to watch in this particular sequence. There are some other lathe canned cycles. We've already seen a G70 in action. G72 does the same kind of idea, only it works on the face of the part. So instead of motion in this direction, it works in this direction. So if you have a part that is, you know, where you're machining on the face of it, you know, where you want to go back and forth, back and forth, back and forth in this direction, then that's what you would use. Then an irregular path stock removal, G73. that's kind of nice if you have like a casting. So let's say maybe you have a casting and you don't have material out here. Let's just say you have a part that looks roughly like this when it's cast, and you have this this casting or this forging that already has this profile, and it's just machining air to come out here and machine all of this. Doesn't make a lot of sense to machine all of that. And so that's what the G73 is good for. They're also threading cycles and others. And then the G80 will cancel the canned cycle. A lot of times you'll see G80s up in the header just to make sure that you don't actually accidentally put in a move that executes a canned cycle. You can also, just like we saw these canned cycles on a mill, they work in a lathe as well. A lot of the same reasons. Okay, so that's the end of that. I'm going to separately do a video, or maybe a series of videos, on programming with Excel, but this one is, I'm going to lop this one off right here.